Hello everyone, happy Friday morning. Thank you for joining us on Master Speak today. On this platform, as you already know, we bring to you some of the best and the brightest minds of our times from all over the world with the idea of helping you find answers to some of the very pertinent questions about future of work, career, life in these unprecedented times. Today, once again, we have a very special guest with us on the show. Last week, we discussed with Jaspreet Binda his views on future of workplace, and today we will talk about future of relationships that humans will have with technology. Sounds very interesting, isn't it? For those of us who are joining us for the first time, thank you for being with us. Please note that you can access any of our previous sessions on our LinkedIn, YouTube, or Facebook handles. So now, as is customary, let's do some important housekeeping checks. I hope all of you who are watching this show and your families are safe and healthy. Give us a big thumbs up by pressing the like icon if it is an astounding yes. Do let us know which part of the country you're joining us from by mentioning your city name in the comment section. Our guest speaker would love to see as to where all which parts of the country you're joining us. I remember two sessions back, we had people joining us from different parts of the world, including Budapest, Colombo, Brussels, so on and so forth. So let's see where all we got today's viewers from. Okay, now share your comments, ask your questions with us throughout the sessions. Make sure that your questions are placed in the comment section. As you would know that at the end of the session, by our speaker, I'm going to be asking those questions to our speaker, and two lucky questions will be given a surprise gift voucher from us. So stay with us through the end of the session, keep your questions coming, and get a shot at being the lucky winner by asking those two lucky questions for the day. Now, with that, let me introduce you to our guest speaker, Rajeev Karwal, on our show. Rajeev is the founder chairman of Milagro Robots, India's number one consumer and commercial service robots company. He is a renowned management thinker and a great professional. Acknowledged as an ethical leader in the Indian industry, he is also considered as a leading brand builder in India. Before founding Milagro Robots in 2007, he has made great contributions in his previous roles at LG as Director Sales and Marketing, Philips as Managing Director Consumer Electronics, Electrolux Managing Director Indian Region, Reliance Digital. He was the founding president and CEO. That's some lineage to talk about, and I'm sure he's got lots to share with us, and we have lots to learn from him. Also, Rajeev has held a 43rd position in Economic Times, India's Most Powerful CEOs list in 2004. He was also Business Today's Top 25 Hot Young Rising Stars of India in 2002, voted one of the Stars of Millennium by the Business India in 2000. He also has written a book called Corporate Blogging in India, which was released in 2008. These days, of course, Rajeev is spending a lot of time with his robots, so we can't wait to hear from you, Rajeev. Thank you so much for joining the show today. Over to you, sir.
It's a pleasure to be here today, and on a topic which is very, very dear to my heart. I have always been fascinated by robots since childhood, and especially after I saw the 1982 movie, which actually started in 1982 in terms of the story of the Bicentennial Man, and the story which was written by Asimov actually talks about the journey of a robot, which is very different from others, and how it evolves, and ultimately after 200 years, and almost like a quest for his life to be a human, he is declared a human. And when I was at LG, that was way back in 1997, we tried to bring in some robots, but they were extremely costly. Then I was at Electrolux as the managing director, maybe around 2003, 2004. Again, we tried to bring in some robots. They were extremely expensive even at that point in time, and the technology was still evolving. It still is. You know, a few experiments here or there with robots. And I finally decided that, you know, this passion has to turn into, you know, a reality through my own efforts. And that is how, you know, we set up Milagro in 2007 and started working on this dream. And finally, 2011, we launched the robots. The kind of robots which you launched were extremely useful, but because of various situations, economic or otherwise, you know, we were waiting for the tipping point to come, and you know, then this pandemic happened. And while it is a sad situation for the humanity in general, but it acted as almost like a trigger for people to realize the benefits of robots, especially for menial tasks, which humans do for serving other humans. I have always been a believer of this, that humans are meant for better things. Humans must, you know, add value of a different nature, because the capabilities intrinsically which God has given us as human beings, we should not be, you know, wasting them cleaning floors or utensils or, you know, cleaning windows, washing windows, cleaning swimming pools, etc. Yes, it is fine that there is a difference in terms of the educational background or the economic background, etc., of various human beings. But, you know, as humanity, we can provide much better opportunities at every level of the economic or the, you know, capability strata of the people, not just in India but across the globe. And now, when, you know, people were forced into a lockdown and the, you know, helps were not able to come to homes, offices, etc., people actually, you know, realized that either they have to work through their own hands, which may be a waste of you know, time, which is the most precious resource which we have. And, you know, no longer could one rationalize, because it was not a one-off thing that, you know, we said, okay, let me do some cleaning, etc., and it's a good exercise for the body. They started to search for alternatives, and, you know, robots suddenly entered the mainstream psyche, and we have seen it in the sales, not just for Milagro, but across the spectrum for all the brands which are providing these robotic solutions for homes, for facility management, for hospitality industry, for healthcare industry, for you know, museums, airports, you name it, or you see wherever you see the robotic potential today. And when we were discussing about the topic for today, when I mentioned to Future that, you know, let's take symbiotic relationship between humans and robots, it was an instant acceptance. Because what is a symbiotic relationship? A symbiotic relationship is something when two species or two organisms come physically close to each other, learn to live in a mutually beneficial relationship. By a classic definition, a robot really can't be, you know, called as another species like a living organism, but it is fast, you know, reaching that level where it is kind of learning to do things and having a lot of degree of freedom. Now, talking about degree of freedom, yes, we will come back to that. You know, let me say this, that human beings are the best creation of God. God has been working on us for billions of years. Yet, God has not given us eyes at the back of our head. Why? Two eyes are good enough. They create with other senses so much of load on the brain for decision making, that if two eyes more were given at the back of our head, we would be confused. The brain would be confused as to what decision to take, which eye to, or the stimuli which the back eyes are giving or the front eyes are giving, what do we do? And as a result, God kind of gave us other senses, the ears from the corner of the eye, seeing that if somebody is behind, etc., etc. So alternative capabilities were given. Robots are the best creation of human beings. And like a human being has to move out of the house, even today, others in the house will tell us, take a mask, don't touch this, don't touch that, you should be careful. These are the times of pandemic. Go carefully on the road. Somebody else may be driving very fast. So God has given us all the intelligence, but yet we also doubt the intelligence of the other, saying that whether he would be or she would be able to take care of themselves or not. Robots being the best creation of human beings also have the same challenges, because when you go out, it is not just what your eyes see or what senses God has given you. Some whole manhole may be open. Somebody might be just, speeding in a very, rapid way, you working on the smartphone and cause an accident and deaths, etc. So similarly, when a robot has to move out of its comfort zone inside your house or in the office, there may be wires which may be left around. There may be pins which would be left around. The battery might finish, like we eat in the morning, the food finishes, and then in the afternoon again we have to recharge ourselves. It is the similar case with a robot, which has to work, and then the battery gets consumed and it has to come back for recharging. These are very, very different from a smart TV in a home. It may be very smart, but the moment you plug it out, it is like a tree. Tree is also a living human being. Living being. But if you ask a tree to move around, it will destroy itself. It will destroy everything else which comes in the way. Same is the thing with the smart refrigerator or TV or whatever. When you look at a mobile phone is almost like a baby in the lap of a mother. It is very smart. You can take it around, but it doesn't have the ability to move on its own, right? And as a result, it requires much, much lesser number of senses to take care of itself, because you are taking care of that baby, right? And a robot, depending upon the degree of freedom it has, is like a human being. It can be an infant, it can be, a small baby who has learned to walk, maybe a teenager who has learned to think and, move around and being able to decide what speed the car is coming from the other side and things like that. So robotic technology is also evolving. But after so many years, or so many billions of years of God working on us, still we need help. Still we need, some sort of an empathetic understanding of our abilities. Same thing we have to give to the robots. When we started to sell the robots, there were lots of people who wanted to see robots in their homes, because it was not an off-the-shelf product, and everybody wanted to see whether, the robot will be able to function in their homes. And a very funny incident happened, from one of the states. Somebody called and asked us, and I just happened to pick up the phone, and he said, to see. And it was triggered by an article which appeared in the Times of India on a Sunday, which actually showed our robot in the shape of a human being, a kind of a robo maid. This person said, So we didn't understand. You know, I thought that maybe it's a question about the machine. So I said, you know, it's about 30,000 rupees. Acha, meri kudi di shaadi hai, matlab my daughter is getting married, I'll give this, de de, wo sara kuch kar degi, ode naal jaake, ode naal chalegi bhi, ode naal ghumegi bhi, matlab shall I gift it to my daughter, you know, in the marriage, and will she move around, take my daughter for a walk, and, you know, clean the utensils, etc. So I'm talking of 2011-12, and so that was the expectation, from a robot. And on the other side, when we used to go into the homes of the person, you know, the robot was moving around, and human beings, what they were doing was, they will come in front of it, prevent it from going out. And they say, you know, look, it is confused. It's like a puppy, you know, in a small corner, it can't move out. So, you know, okay, you can put a puppy, you can put yourself in that place. And if somebody blocks your way, how will you come out? Robots need that understanding, the empathy. Like a human being has a body, a structure, you know, and if we were to we were asked to go through a small hole, we won't be able to go out, you know, through that hole. Same way a robot has a height, it has a width, it has, you know, a depth or whatever dimensions which are hard. So it won't be able to enter into those areas where it is not possible to go. So we need to have that understanding. A robot, just because it is being called a robot, will not develop those abilities, you know, which are invisible like a Mr. India, or flexible, you know, like water, that it will enter into every area. But I was clear right from the start, you know, that if, you know, humans are the best creation of God, and he has given us this structure, which is the hardware, the body structure, then the Atma, which God has developed for us, is the best software, you know. And in that Atma, the inner, voice which God has given us, in a similar way, a robot is the best creation of human beings, and the best software which is given or is being created by the humans, whether it is AI or, you know, IoT or VR or whatever you call it, deep learning, strong AI, the best body or the best hardware to exhibit those capabilities has to be a robotic body, which is able to move around on its own. And the moment that happens, lot of stuff which is dangerous, lot of stuff which we should not be doing as human beings, can be passed on to these robots. The empathy, you know, is something which I have talked about, you know, for a number of times in the last, couple of minutes, is something which is the only aspect which I believe is very difficult for robots to possess. What is empathy from a human perspective? So when I'm talking to you, or you are watching me talk, you are seeing my expressions, you are listening to my tone and tenor, you are even capturing, or your intuitive powers are capturing even the slightest expression which might be appearing in my eyes, and you are processing that information from the capabilities which God has given you, and you will judge me, or you will paint me in a way in your mind that, yes, am I kind? Am I, you know, compassionate? Do I possess, an understanding of other human beings in a way that, if a tear is emanating in the heart of somebody, and before it reaches the eyes, will you be able to judge? Yes, a human being will be able to judge. But a robot would find it extremely difficult to decipher the visceral manifestation of the thinking or the empathetic nature which human beings possess. If you take away that aspect of empathetic understanding of other of the human beings from the robot, today robots and robotic technology is capable of doing practically everything else. Because what is it? What is everything else about us? It is about patterns. It is about, you know, the twitch of a muscle here. Even that pattern, if I say a particular word, that pattern can also be replicated in a robotic face. So robotic technology has evolved today. With the pandemic today, you know, everybody is realizing the need of robots. Just imagine that, you know, when most of the hospitals are delaying the elective surgeries, they are delaying the rehabilitation of people who may have suffered a paralytic stroke, right? What is happening to those people? And as it is, even if this pandemic had not happened, and just imagine that somebody had met with an accident or had paralysis of the hand, and after that, the initial surgery or initial treatment, now if the movement has to come back of this hand and all the fingers have to move like this, and this movement being helped by a nurse, right? So, and how many joints? Here, you know, in every part of the hand, if it has to be done by a human being or held by another human being, versus a glove which can be a robotic glove, which is driven by the software on the computer, is programmed in a way which actually is capturing your strength of the muscles, tendons, and the biorhythm, and is opening your fingers automatically, sitting in the comfort of your house, not having to go to the hospital. What would be convenient? The robotic technology, obviously. Just think of those paralytic people who have given up the hope of walking ever. Someone who is motionless, you know, below the pelvic girdle, is very sharp in his mind, can think, but is depressed that I will never be able to walk ever again. What has gone wrong in the human body? Nothing, the brain is still there. If you have an exoskeleton which you wear on the body, the brain captures the message, transmits it to the exoskeleton motors and actuators, and the exoskeleton makes you stand up. The exoskeleton is powered by a battery, and it makes you bend your knees and take a step forward. Maybe a little bit of training would be required, but that person would be able to walk again. It creation by a human being to help another human being who had given up the hope to walk is something which, if we don't call symbiotic, what else do we call it? So robots are slowly entering into that phase. Robots will be all pervasive. When we look at our homes today in terms of the gadgets, so you have multiple televisions, you have multiple air conditioners, you may have one or two refrigerators, you may have one or two washing machines, you may have telephones, you may have, you know, a voice enabled gadget like Alexa or Google Voice. But all of them do just one thing which they're supposed to do. And a television is of a particular kind, maybe smart or whatever. But they do a specific job only. But if suppose in your home you have a gadget which can do multiple things, can go and stand with you near the kitchen sink and help you cut the vegetables, help you clean the utensils, maybe help you broom up the dust in your home, help you clean the toilet. That kind of a future would come in the homes of multitudes across the globe in the next 5 to 10 years. Last year, just when we were looking at the floor cleaning robots, Milagro and iRobot and a couple of other brands are the only ones today in the market. Last year, combined, according to me, sold not more than 10,000 floor cleaning robots. And the kind of demand which we are seeing today is pointing to a fact that the demand, if supply chain constraints are not a problem in the immediate future, may go up to 300,000 to 400,000 in the year. And when we look at, say, China, the demand for floor cleaning robots is almost 4 million. And Indian market mirrors the Chinese market, maybe with a gap of about 5 to 7 years. iRobot's experience across the globe is also similar. Till last year, the maximum penetration of robotic vacuum cleaners vis-a-vis the normal vacuum cleaners was only 30%. In India, the total market size of vacuum cleaners, not including the car vacuum cleaners, was about 350,000 to 400,000. And this year, if everything goes well, the robotic vacuum cleaners market size will be almost equal. The difference between Europe and India is that in India, the domestic help is not very tech savvy. The homemaker really doesn't want to use those long vacuum cleaner sticks, etc., at home. Of course, in offices you see that, and the husband or the spouse of the homemaker really does not want to participate in the home cleaning, and as a result, the vacuum cleaner becomes a product which always remains in the closet. But a robotic vacuum cleaner will never be a product of the closet, because it will come out on its own, go clean, come back, recharge, go clean. And then the only thing which you have to do is maybe fill the water tank in case it's a wet and dry vacuum cleaner, and clean the dustbin once in a while. So the technology today of robotics is being understood from their benefits point of view, or their advantage point of view, by the consumers today. And that tipping point actually has arrived now because of this pandemic, and the awareness has risen. And I believe that this thing will continue to grow forever. There are adaptations which are required, and that is where, again, the symbiotic aspect comes into play. When we entered into the floor cleaning robots in the end of 2011, early 2012, the robotic technology had not evolved to use self-mapping, independent navigation. The battery technology was still evolving, and the lithium-ion batteries, etc., they had the chance of exploding. So, you really did not want to risk the lives of the people, and as a result, you kept the processes low. But then we realized that in the Indian homes, there are lots of changes which one has to bring in. Indian housewives had realized that grooming is not the right thing which cleans their home properly. So when you are grooming, the dust is going up, settling behind them, they have moved ahead, and then having realized that they have left the dust behind, they started to do the wet mopping. Now the wet mop used to pick up something, wet mop used to get dirty, then you had the bucket to wash, and then the bucket for example, got dirty, the bucket water got dirty, then you put phenyl or some other chemical agents in it, and then, you know, you made it white, that also got dirty. So, but yet the mindset was of wet cleaning. But now, if you look in this pandemic, the doctors are saying that if virus spores have settled somewhere on the floor and you're grooming, they're again going up in the air. It is a big danger. And the robotic vacuum cleaners, when they are moving on the floor, they're not sending up anything in the air. On the carpet also, it is the best thing to happen to carpets that a robotic vacuum cleaner, without destroying the tufts, without sending up anything up in the air, is able to suck up everything under its belly, right? So same way, the robot actually moves, sucks up everything. There is a wet water tank which is behind. You can actually clean the floor in a proper way. So this feedback of the grooming and wet cleaning actually made us do this innovation for the Indian market, which was an electronic water tank. We did that way back in 2014. We were the world's first to do that. And today, almost it has become a norm across the globe. We also realized that the Indian housewife has long hair, and then the underneath of the body, if the brushes are spinning, can get heated up and the hair can catch fire. So fire retardant plastic under the body, large dustbins, the door sills are at a slightly higher height, right? So this feedback and then the robotic technology evolving to make itself more useful from the point of view of the consumer, we had started that, you know, way back in 2011. And today, you know, I think there is much more greater dialogue which is happening with the people. Hospitals, for example, the moment this, you know, the pandemic broke out, and then the reports started to come in that in Italy, almost 30% of the people, I mean, the healthcare workers are getting affected, and many of them are losing their lives. And, you know, we said, what can we do? So from the social distancing point of view, we modified our humanoids, which were meant for hospitality industry, to actually help the doctors, you know, provide a telemedicine, teleconsultation, control the robot. It's an IoT device, moving them from anywhere, you know, taking them to any patient, the robot seeing the patient seeing the doctor's face, you know, one-to-one interaction, the robot wandering around, you know, on its own and giving, preventing a healthcare worker from going in more often. So instead of going four times, if the person goes in only one time and does not have to remove the PPE, is not a danger for other people, PPE itself needs to be cleaned or disposed of. And so that modification happened. This was because there was a dialogue which was taking place. For our floor robots, you know, they came back to us as to how you can make them more useful. So we modified our water tank, and so that it could take the viscosity of the sodium hypochlorite 1% solution, and was able to kill the virus spores on the floor. They came back to us that, is there something which you can do for the air? So we actually changed the grade of filter to HEPA 12. The HEPA 12 filter can actually not just take 99.97% of 0.3 micron dust particles, but can also remove 99.5% of the virus particles which are between you know, above 0.1 micron. The virus COVID spores are between 0.6 to 0.16 micron. So many of the virus, you know, COVID spores can also be filtered by the robot as it is moving around. Then I installed a health ion generator, or the negative ion generator, inside the body of the robot, which actually sends out millions of, you know, ions in the air, and most of the viruses, bacteria are positively charged. So these, you know, ions bring down the positively charged particles on the ground, and on the ground, the sodium hypochlorite solution is able to clean it. So this kind of a dialogue today is very, very beneficial, you know, to the humanity itself. We are working in our labs today on the cooking side. We are working on our labs today on the cleaning of utensils. We are working in our labs today, you know, whether we can have something for keeping the toilets hygienic. And we are also working in our labs today as to how the reception areas can be completely secure, where a humanoid not just acts as a concierge, but also as a security guard, where you can, you know, put it as a human being which is moving around with either offensive or defensive, security capabilities in terms of identification and, uploading, things immediately on the cloud. Somebody walking in and this robot is able to identify the temperature, is able to identify by face and remember in a moving, environment as to which was the person who actually had the temperature, and then recognize and, trace them back, keeping in mind the privacy issues and the laws which still exist, or are getting made as we move along. So, or air duct cleaning robots, where healthy air in the office buildings is extremely essential, where robots can go inside the ducts which are round or rectangular up to maybe 60, 70 feet, are able to not just, sweep and, remove the dust from the sides of the of the cavity, but also is able to suck it out. So there is a lot which is happening. Food delivery robots, for example, are a reality today, and we are working on that, and more use cases are developing. Lot of feedback is coming to us, and we hope that as we move along, there would be more and more beneficial use cases which we will be able to kind of tackle and solve. We are not a very big organization, we are still a small organization, but during this time of last 2 months or so, I've also been thinking a lot about as to how Milagro itself should evolve. And I've realized that unlike televisions or refrigerators industry, where you have one type of technology, here we are tackling with different types of users, different type of technology. Competitors in every sphere are different. And for one organization to have full R&D capabilities or full specialization, and hoping that everything should be branded Milagro, is very, very difficult. But we understand robotics today better than anybody, especially from the front end perspective. That when we entered into the flow robots, that is what we identified as the first area. But when we started to go to the homes, people forced us to say, okay, why don't you bring in a window cleaning robot? Why don't you bring in a lawn mowing robot? Why don't you bring in a swimming pool cleaning robot? Why don't you bring in a back massaging robot? And it was basically because of those demands that we kind of entered into various other categories. And similarly, in the case of hospitality, facility management industries, more demands are coming. So today we are open. I'm saying that Milagro probably should emerge almost like a Skylab, where we have some products of our own, some products belong to somebody else. The fruits of the R&D and effort of many small organizations which will struggle to go across the globe, they can tie up with us, and together we can create a world which is kind, which is solving the problems of humans serving other humans for menial tasks. I believe that has to go, and today with this development which is taking place across the world, and people are struggling to cope up, I believe that robots and humans have reached that stage where today this symbiotic relationship has to be taken to the next level. So this is what, you know, I had to say at this point in time, you know, as a monologue from my side, but I'm open to questions. And Rakesh, maybe, you know, you can help me answer some of the questions which might have come from the people.
Thank you so much, Rajiv, for this interesting talk. So before I ask you some questions, let me just read out one of the comments from our audience in response to what you just shared. So this is from Leena Vasudevan. Very interesting comment she makes. I cannot believe a robot man with so much emotion. It's absolutely amazing. I for one, wasn't I wasn't expecting so much empathy in your talk from this session, but it's quite heartening to see that and the way you presented it. So any comment on what you just heard from Leena? Any reaction from you, Rajiv?
No, you know, the thing is that our slogan is that robots, yes, but our robots also have to be humane, you know, and our division within Milagro is called Milagro Human Tech, you know. So I was very clear right from day one that, you know, until and unless the robots are made in such a way that they are humane and they understand that a human being looks at technology initially in its journey as almost, if you remember, you know, that our grandmothers, when the TVs came to our homes, they even touched the remote control as if something will happen to the remote control. When we were growing up, when the first time, you know, the laptops came, we were very scared of pressing any button saying that, okay, something might happen, you know. Same, the robotic technology is also evolving. And if the robotic technology is presented, the hardware and software is presented in such a way that it is intuitive, you know, and go back to the Nokia phones. Why did Nokia phones become so successful? Because the interface was so intuitive, right? And people lapped up Nokia phones like anything. So that was probably a humane aspect, you know, in that phone at that point in time. Similarly, all our robots have to possess that. Yes, Rakesh.
Yes. Well, that's a fair point you made, Rajiv. There's another comment from Mohammed Asif who says that we are proud to see such progress made by India's own robotic brand. So that's really awesome to hear that, Rajiv. And a leading question from there is that from this pandemic situation, have you seen this accelerating your business potential, and are you more bullish about the future, especially after what we are going through?
Yes, yes. I had actually alluded to that in my talk. We are seeing almost a 3,000 to 4,000% increase in terms of demand on the floor vacuum cleaners. There is a huge increase in interest in the window cleaning robots, the swimming pool cleaning robots, because although swimming pools are not open at this point in time, the air duct cleaning robots. And there is a massive interest by the corporates, you know, and facility management companies for our humanoids now. And also by the restaurants and the hospitality industry for our food delivery robots, which earlier, you know, was a little bit skeptical. And now people are coming back and saying that, okay, let's, you know, see what we can create together. Hardware capabilities exist. You know, it is now that our company has to work with individual corporates, etc., on the humanoids to develop more use cases. A humanoid can be not just a receptionist, it can also be a salesperson behind the counter. It can itself independently be the checkout counter. We can have robotic vending machines at airports, you know, which are moving around and actually going to the customers rather than the customers coming to these, you know, vending machines. They can be self-cleaning, they can be self-diagnostic. There is so much which is possible. Yes, cost is an aspect, but as the volume increases, costs will also come down. Rakesh.
Yes. Super. A curious question from me, Rajiv, then. We can understand from a you know, commercial use perspective, but for domestic use, for normal consumers like me, how affordable are these robots? And how do you sort of communicate the payoff to your customers?
Yeah.
To help them bring their home help at home, if I can call it.
You know, so it's a very, very good question. And, you know, a lot of people ask the same question. For corporates, it's a very easy decision because, you know, if suppose it is a robotic vacuum cleaner in a hotel, for example, and a housekeeper if is taking 30% of the time in cleaning the floors of the room and the washroom, bathroom, etc. And they have this robot. The moment they enter into the room and they leave that robot on the floor, they are able to save 30 to 40% of their time. So if there are 10 housekeepers in a hotel, then you can easily say that 30 to 40% manpower saving is possible, and then they can do the other job efficiently. You know, whether it depends upon the hotel, whether they want to save manpower or whether they want to use them more efficiently elsewhere. In a home also today, you know, what happens is that today in the metro cities, it is not that the maid servants come at a low cost. You know, today 6 to 15,000, you know, 20,000, depending upon the kind of work which we use the maid servants for. And robotic technology on the floor cleaners, actually, the prices vary from about 20 to 25,000 rupees to about a lakh of rupees, you know, and it depends upon the independence you want. If you want a completely independent self-navigating robot where you only have to touch the dustbin and the water tank, then you have to pay between 80,000 to 100,000. If you want a lesser or you settle with a lesser comfort where 30 to 35% of your home can be done independently, and thereafter you have to go after the robot, you know, and maybe take it from one room to another, maybe the cost will be about 20-25,000 rupees. But it also depends upon the size of a person's, you know, home. So if it's a only two bedroom home, you know, maybe you don't require to spend 80-90,000 rupees. You can do with 25-30,000 rupees. So it depends upon the need. The payback periods definitely should be less than a year in most of these products. Rakesh.
Interesting, Rajiv. That's an argument we're taking forward in our households for all those people who are stuck at home working and also have to do domestic chores. I think you should look at this session and hear more clearly. Thank you, Rajiv. I'm going to move to questions from our audience, a bunch of it that I see and more coming through. The first question is from Anand Tamboli, and he's asking this interesting question, which I suspected will be the first question. Every robot that replaces a human job creates some level of inequality in society. How do you think companies that make robots can help in bridging this divide? And how is your company tackling this issue?
Okay. You know, actually, it's a great question. But probably, you know, we have to kind of step back, disengage ourselves and detach ourselves from our current problems in the economy, etc., and then think. And let's not talk about India. Let's talk about, say, a Germany versus a Vietnam or maybe a China or any other low-cost economy. If Germany, which has an aging population, Germany, which has salary levels which are extremely high, but a Germany where today the respect for life is much higher than many other countries. If this country has to get back its competitiveness, how will it do? How will it get back its competitiveness? It has to invest in robots today. When it invests in robots today, it will take care of its own population. It will create more jobs. It will probably be able to take in more immigrants in its economy to serve not just its own people, but also make and supply products to the world. Remember that ultimate decision making still is with the human beings. Now, if China has to preserve its competitiveness today, and China is ahead of India, but still there is a huge amount of poverty, there is an income disparity between a China and a Germany, then China has to understand that today it has to invest in robotics so that tomorrow somebody else should not be able to steal its power of manufacturing and supplying across the globe, and China is doing it. If India has to create a place for itself across the globe, it has to emerge as a power in the manufacturing world. We have to invest in robots. Don't worry about whether it will take away a few low-rung jobs. If we as a country emerge as a supplier of products across the globe, we get back our global competitiveness. We will create a much, much bigger growth. There will be a different kind of job openings or opportunities which will come in the economy. We have to reinvent our education. Today, look at it like this, that, in the IT field, there are so many people who can't speak good English, but are able to play with Photoshop, with CorelDRAW. They're able to do website programming, languages, etc., in HTML or Python or whatever. They're able to do without even understanding proper English, and they are contributing to the globe, with their low cost rates, in terms of supplying, and global companies are outsourcing this job to the Indians. So did IT take away work, or did IT create a new set of people who are competing with the best and bringing job to the Indians? Same way, robotic technology will also require, programming at the back end, and more languages are becoming easier with, icons. Like today in WhatsApp, we are using emoticons, and instead of writing 5 words. So same way, icons, iconic languages are emerging. So we should not fear technology. We should not fear advancement. It's an idea whose time has come. If you don't do it, somebody else in the world will do it. There are religions which have become extinct. They have lost their relevance because they refuse to accept modern technology of printing, of communication. And as a result, those religions which evolved are the religions which have also spread across the globe. So technology is to be embraced. Anything which a human being can imagine would become a reality tomorrow. And we cannot run away with it just because it makes our present uncomfortable. We have to think of ways and means how to be relevant and be cutting edge for the challenges which will come tomorrow. Rakesh.
Excellent. Rajiv, very well said. And I think the lesson there is that at a macro level, this brings in a lot of opportunities, and there is a multiplier effect to bringing technology. In the short term, however, one could feel that there is a loss. But I guess other argument that you earlier made, Rajiv, was about productivity enhancement, because a lot of talented people out there may still be stuck doing menial jobs, which pretty much is a waste of time, effort. And this is where the robots can come in and unlock some of that potential. So I think very well said, Rajiv. I would dive into this next very interesting question from Baiju. Baiju Joseph, who's also our Chief Technology Officer, and he's firing a lot of questions your way. But I'll pick one that I find very interesting. This question is, will artificial intelligence evolve into artificial consciousness in the future? Artificial consciousness. Uh-huh. And he's saying something which I must confess, I can't understand too much. I'm not a techie. AI researchers and scientists have been discussing the axiomatic and technological implications of building artificial consciousness. So, I think the debate is more to do with, will artificial intelligence over a period of time start understanding the context and therefore the feeling and therefore empathy and some of the stuff that you spoke of earlier in your session? Is this something that we are heading towards?
You see, this is inevitable, as robots become mainstream. You see a lot of countries now enacting laws, changing, the way we look at robots. Because look at who is taking certain jobs in certain economies. Robots are taking jobs in certain economies because they're more efficient, they don't have to go for lunch, they don't require leaves, they are not well, it's not that they are well on one day or they are unwell on another day, they don't take casual leaves, they don't gossip around, you know, they don't question the boss, etc., etc. So people whose jobs are gone, they were responsible for something, right? They were questioned for something. The robots which have taken these jobs must also be questioned on the same things. You know, they also have their KRAs. Maybe, yes, some KRAs and job descriptions can change, but we must fix the responsibility of the robots also. So the laws are being enacted to say that, okay, if the robot has taken the job of a human being, a robot should be also answerable on the similar parameters as a human being was answerable, right? Now, if suppose we say, and you know, this bicentennial man, if we go back to that, and I think everybody who wants to understand the journey of robots must see this movie. It is a wonderful movie, and it will actually tell you about what are the challenges which will come, because this robot, you know, in the story, got made in 1982 and dies in 2064 or something, you know. And I find more and more the way robotic technology is evolving, almost mirroring that path. So you must see this movie. Now, in this movie, you know, similar kind of attempts get made that, okay, this robot which has feelings, which can create, think, has a lot of cognitive abilities, you know, because robots, what are the five thinking skills? You know, we start from remembering, and then, you know, maybe understanding, then analyzing, you know, and then, you know, kind of putting plans in place after analyzing to execute what our thinking is, and then actually ending up creating. The robot, when it starts to create, then human beings start to fear that will things go out of hand. And that is how the many fictional films which happened in Hollywood, which were, you know, even Rajnikant's movie, two movies, if you see, you know, the fear of the robots. And it is in the same, you know, Bicentennial Man, the US Robotics Research Center says that, okay, from now onwards, no individual robot will have a brain of its own, and we will have a central brain which controls. What is more dangerous? Right? Think. So just because we imagine things that things can go out of hand, it is not that we have to discard the robotic technology. We have to enact laws. We have to establish standards. We have to have collaboration. We have to have checks and balances in the society. Because this is an idea whose time has come. You cannot stop this from happening, right? But you can control it. You can have a good dialogue and make this to be a very beneficial, technology, and which grows for the benefits of the human beings across. So let's look at technology with a positive feeling, and you know, we will find that it will only increase in terms of utility for us in our day-to-day lives. Rakesh.
Thank you, Rajiv, and shout out to all our audiences who are asking these questions. Please keep your questions coming. We've got another 15 minutes to go. Remember, two lucky questions will be identified by the end of the show for lucky gift voucher. Rajiv, the next question is from Rajat S. I think this takes on to what you had responded to, the question which Anand had asked, and you had mentioned China and Germany. China's response to Germany's development of technology. The question is, with respect to the geopolitical changes this pandemic is driving, China was the outsourcing capital of the world, and a lot of high-end tech work was being done there. Why do you think that we've been slow to compete and respond to this opportunity? And does this pandemic now offers us an opportunity that we should not miss? And what should entrepreneurs be doing to leverage this?
Yeah, it's a fantastic question, because it is a fantastic question, and because, you know, we live in times where sometimes it is very difficult to answer in a straight way. But let me attempt to address this. Today, you know, I do not participate too much in CII, FICCI, you know, and many other forums, because I'm a little bit disenchanted and kind of disappointed. Because when we started off, we, you know, went to them and we wanted to reach out to the government and, you know, other places. So the understanding of this technology, what it can do and how we can be more competitive is missing. There were people who even felt that, you know, we should not use the word robots. We should call it smart manufacturing, or we should, you know, call it by some other name, automation, etc., etc., because the government or other people or many other, you know, vested interests in the society are worried about job losses and, you know, votes and things like that. And but you can call it by any other name. You know, a private industry which wants to improve its productivity has to adopt robotic technology. So until and unless, you know, we start to have national plans of gaining competitiveness, we will not get anywhere. There was a forum which I attended where a very big, you know, technology leading, you know, educational institution in the country was given land free by the government, and that, you know, institution, the only thing which they could think of was how to lease out, you know, some portions of that land which on which they will build some, you know, rooms and offices, etc., to some people and collect their, you know, income from rent, rather than thinking that such a huge land piece has been given, how we can make it one of the centers of excellence for technology and on path breaking, you know, stuff where we can lead the world. That thinking is missing. Today, we don't even have an internet backbone in this country, which is high speed, which will bring in these technologies and benefits to every nook and corner of this country in the best way possible. And we are dependent on private enterprises to provide us, you know, the dongles and, you know, the mobile phones, etc. And they are of good speed, bad speed, you know, everybody knows. So if you want to lead the world, you need to have a national strategy. You need to have political leaders, economic leaders, corporate leaders on the same page, which we who say that, whose passion is to get competitiveness and create wealth for this industry, for this country, for generations. If they look at only next 3 years or 5 years, or what do you say, you know, some vested interests of theirs or for their families, how would you create the kind of industry which some other countries have created? Our problem is that. Our problem is lack of a national plan on anything which is of tremendous future consequence for this nation. Sorry to be saying it, but that is the reason why we are not leading the world in robotics. In China, I have studied it from schools to universities, to linking the universities to the angel investors, to the SME clusters who adopt the technology, to market development funds participating in exhibitions, to linking them to organizations which will fund the prototypes, who would change the prototypes, write off those grants, 10-year tax holiday for firms which are working in future technologies, every kind of tax holiday, to every small and medium enterprise in the country, in China, not having to see physically any inspector of any nature coming from the government. Those are things which enhance entrepreneurship. Those are things from which result from, you know, in innovation coming from the lab, reaching out to the world. We need a drastic change. It is not that we don't understand And it is not that we have not talked about it as a nation. It is also not that we have not experimented with these things in small ways. But it is the way we are structured today and the way we provide lip service to almost everything and the execution is simply missing. That is where the problem lies. Rakesh.
Right. The next one, again, I'll just pick up a question from Beju, and I'll extend that question, I think, with another question that I see on the panel, Rajiv. I think the question is more about artificial intelligence and the role it's playing in robotics technology development. So Beju's question is, how do you see a mobile robot, when will a mobile robot be capable to gauge human interaction interest before approaching a human? So if before somebody approaches, can robot gauge the emotion of the human so that the interaction can be modeled accordingly? Is this something that can happen very soon? Is already happening?
Yeah, so it is already happening. But the only thing is emotion, which is of expression nature in terms of expression, not empathy or the visceral aspects which are happening inside your body. So robots are able to read today any human image, emotion which comes on the face or the body language. They are capable of doing it, right? And today there are mobile robots which are able to, capture and respond accordingly. But they are very costly. They have not come mainstream at this point in time. So slowly you will see that this will happen. You know, the Sophia, for example, which was demonstrated. We are in touch with many companies, who are working on similar, technologies. We as an organization don't have the capability to develop those kind of robots at this point in time. But yes, it is happening and you will find them mainstream. Reading emotions, yes. Empathetic, maybe not, because it will take a lot of time, for even the scientists to decipher how many levels of, neural networks we have within our own brain, and that research is still happening. So the depths of human evolution and then, kind of replicating them in the robots is an ongoing task. And I'm sure, in the coming years, you will find more and more robots which are able to strike independent conversations and modify those conversations based on the emotions which they are reading on the face or tone and tonality of the human being on the other side.
True that. I think you spoke of Sophia, and I was bringing that question up, Rajiv, from Sridhar. I think Sophia was introduced to the world in flesh, as we saw, sometime in 2017 and 18. So how long before you see such robots being commonplace in the world? How far are we from having Sophia sitting next to us in the drawing room or walking in the mall with us?
You see, I think there are a couple of things. So one is the robotic technology itself. Second is that what things does this robotic technology possess, So this robotic technology, which is independent, should also be able to do face recognition. Now, face recognition with a database or face recognition simply like a Google Lens or, searching from the web and then immediately replacing it and replicating it and say, okay, hello, Mr. So-and-so. Right. So there are many such issues also. So technology, cost, laws, as the three of them are combining, you will see more and more such things coming up. Even emotions also today, everything costs. So you have a robot who is able to move the nostrils, a robot which is able to move the eyes and the eyelids. Is a robot which is able to, move the forehead to the chin, or simply the lips. You require material of different kind. You require the hardware under the skin, which is flexible of a different kind, to be able to create those emotions. So, or expressions of those emotions. So, technology exists today. Use cases and collaboration from real utility point of view has to be arrived at. So, if it's an industry which says, you know, okay, or an industrialist, I mean, who says, okay, I am happy with a telepresence robot which I can drive sitting in Mumbai in my factory in Gurgaon, and I am able to move around this robot which simply is, you know, a mobile base with a, you know, mobile phone on top of it, and I am able to go to every table and see and say hi to everybody, and it works for about 40,000-50,000 rupees. I'm happy because it provides me utility. But instead of another human being which is my body double in my shape, which is able to move around, but it comes for 40 lakh rupees. So maybe it is useful, but the same thing can be done for with lesser costs. And today there is no real need. Yes, it is good to have. A lot of people will desire to have it, but costs have to come down. And today, as sensors, motors, actuators, battery technology, as they are evolving, as the volumes are increasing, you know, as the processing capability of the CPUs is increasing, the costs are coming down and the speed is going up. And everything, remember, will have to depend on the Wi-Fi. The Wi-Fi also needs to be of a good quality. And then you will see that these things will become more mainstream. Rakesh.
Thank you. Thank you, Rajiv. I think last two questions before we end the show for today, which I don't want it to be over, but we are cognizant of your time. So, Rajiv, in our conversation yesterday, I asked you about what prompted you to start Milagro and take all the risk when you were at the peak of your career. And of course, you shared your thoughts with me. For the purpose of our audience, a lot of them are entrepreneurs, you know, professionals who may be looking at crossing the line to go on the other side. Can I ask you to share a bit about your journey in the last 10 years since you launched Milagro? What changes did you have to adjust to and make in yourself to become an accomplished entrepreneur that you are today?
So I think I haven't accomplished much, but yes, I want to accomplish, you know, a lot and much more. And I want to build an institution which I'm proud of, which survives me. And, you know, because organizations don't come with an expiry date, and you know, future generations can carry them forward as long as you know, humanity is alive. But you know, leaving you know, organizations like LG or Philips, Electrolux, Reliance, and then at the peak of my career, I was 43 at that point in time when I started the organization in 2007. Was a difficult decision, but I realized that even as, you know, my salary is increasing, positions, designations are increasing, essentially the job which is remaining, which is there, is almost similar. I was also losing touch, you know, with the ground level realities, with the people at the front line, and I was trying to find ways and means to communicate, you know, either through writing blogs or, you know, coming on the social media or addressing, you know, town hall meetings and things like that. And, you know, something inside me kind of started to prompt me, you know, that do something of your own in such a way that you're not sometimes untrue to yourself or your inner voice. Because whatever you say, you can be the highest position, but sometimes you end up taking decisions from the economic point of view, which may not be correct, you know, morally or ethically. And that is what I thought that I won't do. And that is why I kind of withdrew. And also in those cases, what happens is the stresses which you carry home are very malignant, you know. At the highest level, you know, you feel, okay, you know, I'm doing something else. Even I'm thinking of something else or any other company, I'm doing it, you know, injustice to my current company, or I'm thinking of an idea, but how will this idea fit into my current company, etc., etc. So today, you know, when we have Milagro, there are stresses, you know, and we operate completely on internal accruals. I don't have any debt. I don't have any equity from outside. Capital is always a limitation. But it is not killing me. Those stresses are not killing me because they are, I'm doing the business the way I want to do. We do an ethical business. We do a small business. We don't, we are not answerable. We only have to take probably from others. We don't have to give money to, you know, anybody. And I'm able to have a peaceful life. The initial things, when you leave a very high position and start a company, you know, so when I started, there were lots of people who said, you know, you're starting this thing from a very small company with your own money. You can raise such a huge money. You have such a good name. You have such a big name. I said, no, I don't want to do that. I want to start from the very basics because I feel that I'm out of touch with the reality. And believe me, when I started to go around the country, I realized that actually I knew 10% of what I thought I knew about India. I never had the time to understand people. I never had the time to understand ecosystems because I was in a big position. Wherever I went, somebody will pick my bag. Somebody, you know, even in the Jet Airways or somebody will identify you, Mr. Karwal, you know, please come. I go somewhere, Mr. Karwal, everywhere somebody will say, you know, and I will go not even prepare myself for any talk. I will just go give a talk and come back very quickly as if I'm the most important person on the earth. Not, I will give away something which may or may not have been appropriate to the audience, but I would not have enriched myself by what that environment would have offered to me. I had become that kind of an individual when I was serving others. Today, no, it's not that. Wherever I go, I'm able to learn, I'm able to imbibe, I'm able to improve myself, I'm able to improve my organization, I'm able to contribute back to the society along with what I'm doing at Milagro. So that is, you know, what has happened to me after becoming an entrepreneur. Everybody has a different journey. Everybody has their own thought processes. But mine is this, and I can share you only what happened to me or what is happening to me. Rakesh.
Thank you, Rajiv. And just one last question from what you just said. What is that one or two piece of advice that you want to give to our viewers who are working in the corporate, who have ambitions to grow in their career, probably let's say at mid-level, from your experience as a top shot corporate and as an entrepreneur, just one or two pieces of advice that you would want to give to our audience today?
Yeah, so I think a couple of things, you know, remember that the moment you are on the wrong side of 40s, companies start to look at you in a different way, you know, and there are always youngsters, you know, more well-read, more contemporary, you know, who are willing to take the position which you are in, like you took somebody else's position when you were rising. So it is very important to keep yourself relevant by continuously investing in your knowledge, in your skills, and never giving up doing the work through your own hands and not losing touch with the reality on the ground. This is very important to have a longevity and being able to compete with the new people. So if today Federer has to survive or play the next couple of years, or a Dhoni has to, you know, survive in the IPL for in the next couple of years, he has to invest in his body skills and, you know, the sinking of the eye reflex movements and whatever. And I remember, you know, Dhoni answering some journalist's question a couple of years ago that, is there anybody who can run faster than me? Is there anybody who is more physically fit than me? You know, and if not, I have a career ahead. So similarly, you know, corporate leaders who are in their, you know, 40s must do this. Second aspect is, wherever you are, work as if it is your own organization, whether you are an entrepreneur or whether you are in the corporate world. If you have that ownership, because skill sets many will have, knowledge base also many will have, but what companies are looking for or what converts or snatches victory from the jaws of defeat is the sense of ownership for your organization, be it your own or for your employers. If you can have that ownership mindset, and that is getting more and more limited because of the pressures on all sides on individuals, till the time you are there in that organization, in a particular position, own it completely and take it to the logical conclusion like a true professional, and you will never have a reverse in your life. These are the only two advices which I want to give Rakesh to the audience today.
Thank you so much, Rajiv. I think the second bit of advice resonates with me very strongly. That was the first advice I got on day one of my job when I was stepping out of a house, and my uncle had given me this exact same advice around ownership. So that resonates with me. I'm sure it resonates with a lot of people who are watching us today. With that, thank you very much, Rajiv, once again for being on the show, for sharing so openly about Milagro, about your work and what you are doing, and your thoughts around how humans have to engage with robots and be prepared, rather take advantage of what technology is offering us. So it was very enlightening. I would like to thank all our audience for watching the show today. I think it's time for us to just pick up those two lucky winners. And I have the names ready. First question is from Anand Tamboli. And that was the first question that I asked of Rajiv. Anand, congratulations. Please let us know your email ID so we can ship those vouchers to you. If you are still listening, I hope you're still there. And the second question for the day is from Rajat S. On the geopolitical changes this pandemic is driving. Please let us know your email ID so we can ship the vouchers. Congratulations to you.
And congratulations.
Thank you very much, Rajiv, for being on the show. It was a pleasure to have you
today. Same here. I'm honored. Thank you.
All right, that brings us to the end of the show. I cannot close the show without thanking our community support partners. Thank you very much, Resultix, AdGully, Paul Reiter, and Netcore for helping us spread the message far and wide to the audiences to help them know that this is an important initiative being taken by Future Generali India Life Insurance. Thank you very much for your partnership here. And thank you to our audience for joining us. We look forward to seeing you on the next session next week. I think it's on Wednesday. We have, maybe I'll ask Ashish to prompt me. I think you've got two sessions next week. Ashish, if you're there, it would just help if you could.
Yeah, Rakesh. So next we have on 22nd June at 6 p.m. with Dr. Ramanan Lakshmi Narayan on reality check on unlocking what lies ahead. Dr. Ramanan Lakshmi Narayan is the director for CCDC, which is Center for Disease Dynamics and Economic Policy.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Ashish, and thank you.